Ready, set, go? Okay, so I'm going to talk to you briefly about what I started recently calling machine learning, and in particular focusing on an overview of the field, looking at advanced theories, systems that support the theories and applying, deploying the theories, and I will briefly touch on application areas, so I will not look at any application in great detail. So, what is machine arguing? It's another way to call what's also referred to as argumentation in AI. And it's about designing and building machines that can argue. So endowing machines with the capability of arguing. And that's particularly useful when there are conflicts in the information available to the machines. And the conflict could be within the machines themselves or across different machines. When there is incomplete information and gaps need to be filled. And when there is a need to explain the outcome, for example, of the machine operation. So in all these settings, the capability of arguing is useful, if not essential. So what I'm going to cover in this brief tutorial is a number of theories. I will, in particular, focus on which one is. I will in particular focus on abstract argumentation, structured argumentation, and bipolar argumentation. These are the three things I will mostly focus on. But I will also tell you a little bit on extending these frameworks with preferences and with probabilities. So abstract argumentation is the most famous, the like seminal approach within machine arguing. It's about dealing with problems that can be abstracted away in terms of what I call webs of disagreement. So the focus of the presentation is on disagreement, on conflict. So we will look at what we call semantics of abstract argumentation, not just what they are, but what it means to reason within them, supported by semantics. And there are two ways to formulate semantics, via extensions, which are basically sets of winning arguments, and by labelings that point to which arguments are good, which ones are bad, and which ones are undecided. So this is the first part, and we will have a small break to play the system that will help you firm your understanding of labelings. Then I look at structured argumentation, which is basically a formalism or a class, a kind of a catalog of formalism, if you like. Well, arguments are not black boxes, are not abstract entities, you cannot really look inside, but they have a structure. And disagreement is, again, something you can infer from building blocks for what it means to disagree. And I will, in particular, focus on assumption-based argumentation, which is the kind of structured argumentation I am possibly best known for. Then I will touch upon bipolar argumentation, which is allowing to model settings where you can disagree, as in abstract argumentation, but you can also argue by means of a support relation. And I will look at two interpretations of support within this kind of frameworks, and a new type of semantics that the frameworks are often equipped with, namely gradual semantics. I will also show you that these frameworks are really instances of structured argumentation. Okay, that the specific types of structured argumentation in particular are. So this is the main bulk of the tutorial. I will also touch upon, as I said, the case where you have preferences over arguments in abstract argumentation, and kind of the case in which you've got probability distributions together with abstract argumentation frameworks. So in terms of systems, we look at ROAD2H, which is the one I've asked you to focus on. It was developed by a former PhD student of mine, and it's about labeling after the implementation frameworks. We will look at a system for ABBA, which is called ABBA Plus. It also allows to deal with preferences, but we will not play with the preferences in this tutorial much. And then we look at ArgonDeck, which is the system that I've asked you to register for bipolar argumentation frameworks under a specific graduate semantics. Okay, so let's start with an example. So this is, in a sense, I've given you a little bit of what we're going to do. Let's start with an example which is also indicative of the class of applications. limitation is requiring non-monotonic with visible reasoning. It's a real, it's a genuine and a true example. This is the policy of my bank, nationwide, for covering myself and all the account holders when they travel by car, if the car breaks down. So this is a summary of their policy, and you can see that there are underpinning, underlying conflicts within this policy. But the policy says that I am covered. Sorry, this. That I'm covered for breakdown in any type of car that I'm traveling in, but I'm not covered if the private car is not registered to me unless I am in the vehicle at the time of the breakdown. So this is a typical example of a policy, of a regulation. There is a generic rule, there are exceptions to the rule, and there are exceptions to the exceptions, and so on. So it's an example of conflicting rules, if you want, rules that may all apply at the same time, and you need to resolve the conflict and decide what is the outcome. Am I covered for this particular breakdown in this particular car at this particular time, or am I not? So that's a class of applications that argumentation has been applied to. And if you focus just on these bits I have searched and I have talked to, we can see that in order to determine whether what the policy says about a specific account holder, Mary, that is traveling in a friend's car and the car breaks down, in order to determine whether she's covered or not, an argumentation process needs to take place. So there is an argument for Mary to be covered. I represent it as C Mary, in short, using the first bit of the rule. This is using. I'm not good at it, or it's not good. One of the things. Let's really not think. So there is an argument for Mary to be kind of covered because of the first, the first rule. She's an account holder, but there is an objection, which we call in argumentation an attack against his argument, by an argument for Mary not to be covered using the second rule, bit of the policy. There is, however, a counter argument against this argument, which is an objection against it, which is given by the bottom bullet point. This argument is activated, if you like, by the fact that Mary was in the vehicle at the time of the breakdown. So there is an argument from applying the first bit of the regulation, of the policy. There is a counter argument, an objection against this argument, by applying the first bit of the second aspect of the policy. And there is a third counter argument, which is obtained by applying the unless bit of the second policy. So this is an argumentative process, argumentation, whichever form of argumentation one is looking at, is adopting, if you like, this understanding of the application of these rules. What argumentation frameworks do or are equipped with is ways to determine what is dialectically good in this context, or what is dialectically strong or strongest. So in this particular setting, one could say that E Mary, the bottom argument, and C Mary, the first argument, are together dialectically good. Why? Because I'm trying to convey the intuition only here, not giving you further definitions. Because E Mary is defending C Mary against the objection given by N C Mary. So the two of them together are dialectically good, because one defends the other against an argument, which is counter. Also, one could say that in Mary is dialectically the strongest. Why? Any feeling as to why?
It's not an effect of anything.
There are no objections against. can begin to be the strongest because nobody has anything to say about it in this dialogue. Okay, so what abstract argumentation does, and what is structured argumentation, is providing a frame within which these arguments can be, if you like, captured, and the relationships between these arguments can be captured, and defining ways to determine what is dialectically good and dialectically strong. So let's see abstract argumentation first. An abstract argumentation framework is very simply a pair. The first component of the pair is a set. It can be anything, but we call them arguments. And we call them arguments because of the second element of the pair. The second element of the pair is a binary relation over arguments, over the set of arguments, that represent disagreement. It represents what we call attack. So we can say that if a pair AB belongs to the relationship of attacks, then A attacks B. You can represent these frameworks as directed graphs, and that's what typically one does. And the particular example of the breakdown coverage that we saw can be represented as a directed graph, so as a master documentation framework, very simply as given there. We've got in-memory, attacking NC-memory, attacking C-memory. So each edge represents a pair in the attacks relation. So the edge, the arrow, really represents attacks. So this in-memory attacks NC-memory, which attacks C-memory. So what we typically do, as I've already done, is use this reading for this pair belonging to the relationship of attacks, and we lift the relationship of attacks from pairs of, from arguments to sets of arguments and hybrid. A set of arguments attacks another set, or a set of arguments attacks a single argument. So it's just a way to lift this notion from individual arguments to sets of arguments, or mixed. Okay, so that's what an abstract argumentation framework is. So an abstract argumentation framework is really an abstraction of a problem where there is disagreement. That's why I call this framework where there is disagreements. Really, what you're focusing on is what disagrees with what. Nothing else, because the single individual nodes of the graph, the single arguments, can be anything. And indeed, the abstract argumentation admits very many instances, including instances where the nodes are pairs of strategies in a game theoretic sense, or whether the nodes are data points in data sets that are used for training machine learning classifiers. So these individual nodes don't need to be arguments to be understood in a human sense. They can be really anything. As soon as you have a disagreement between these elements, you call them up. So now, once we have made this abstraction, we need to decide how to determine what's dialectically good or dialectically strong, as we saw before. So this is done in abstract argumentation and in other argumentation frameworks as well, by means of what can be seen to be recipes. And these recipes we call semantics, and the sets of good arguments that these recipes return, we call them extensions. This is just syntax, right? What's important is that there are ways to determine whether a set of arguments is good. Now, there are very many such ways, and here I'm only giving you some examples. The first is the simplest. It basically sanctions a set of arguments A as good if and only if it is conflict-free, which means that the set does not attack itself, which in turn means that no argument in the set attacks any argument in the set. So that's a basic requirement. We're trying to do, we've got webs of disagreement. The first thing we need to do is resolve conflicts, and conflict freeness is a standard requirement. Then we have admissibility, which is the next simplest one, which basically says, okay, conflict free is not enough. We also want to be able to integrate a dialectical notion of defense against objections. So an admissible set is one that is conflict-free and that attacks every attacking argument. So if you disagree with me, I want to be able to disagree back with you, to defend myself against your disagreement, or to bring in somebody who can disagree with you. So I and somebody can be a winning team. So that's what
I've heard about this ground distinction, which is actually the reason you don't talk about this is because you attach no importance.
No, because I am first doing what I call the credulous semantics.
Okay.
I'm touching upon, but that's a good point. So all of these semantics may sanction very many sets as good. They are credulous. You can choose this good set of good sets. There are other semantics, including the grounded one, that instead will only tell you that there is one single good set. They don't take any chance. These will take chances, we can even have a chance and we can see why in a set. So within actually specifically this example, we can see that any scenario is conjugate free on its own. The empty set is conjugate free. Just scenario is conjugate free. Each individual singleton set of arguments is conjugate free. So there are very many conjugate free sets. This is not conjugate free. Because these are tax set. In terms of admissibility, imary alone is admissible, it's conflict free, and is not attacked, as we saw before. So it defends itself against all attacks because there isn't any. So this is admissible. Ancillary is not admissible because although it's conflict free, it does not defend itself against this attack. And there are other admissible sets, for example, the empty set. And imary scenario is also admissible. Actually, imary scenario is everything else. The other things I haven't told you. The one maybe I should think about, because we'll look at it later on with the labelings, is complete. So complete, and which is important for grounding. So a complete extension is an admissible extension. So it's conflict free and it defends itself against attacks. But it also contains every single argument that it defends. So there is an element of maximality. You know, you not only are defending yourself, but if you defend something, that something is with you. So you kind of expand it. So in this particular case, imary alone is not complete, as I say there, is not complete because it defends scenery by attacking the only attack against it. So because it defends it, scenery needs to be with it for the set to be complete. Another interesting notion is that of stability. This is the most aggressive, is the total, the totalitarian semantics, if you like. A set is stable if it is conflict free and it attacks everything it does not contain, everything outside. So in this particular case, imary alone is not stable, because it only attacks this element does not belong to it, it does not attack that. So the only stable set is the one that has these two, and it attacks everything outside. This alone is not stable because it attacks this, not that. So you've got various recipes for determining what is dialectically good, and these recipes match to some extent what humans do in certain settings, and they have also some mathematical underpinnings that we're not focusing on. So let's look at some examples. I've already given you the solution here. I should have animated you to ask it. So what happens to this? This is a debate with two disconnected parts. A attacks B and B attacks A, so they attack one another, and C attacks itself. Okay? So it's a contradictory statement. So, in this particular case, there is no stable extension. Can you tell me why?
You cannot spot a set of arguments that they're both conflict free and that attack each other argument outside.
Indeed, in particular, C can neither be in nor out. Because if it's in, you've got country freeness violated. If it's out, you can't attack. So there is no choice, and this one, you know, no chance that this may have a stable extension. There are two preferred extensions which are maximally admissible, so maximally country free and such that they defend against all attacks. And these are A and B, so C is completely ignored. And there are three complete extensions, A on its own, B on its own, and the empty set. So A is complete because B is admissible. It defends itself against the only attack, which is B. It is contained in defense because it only defends itself. Similarly for B. But the empty set is also complete because it defends nothing at all. And it's trivially country-free and admissible. It defends nothing at all. So that empty set, the complete extension empty set there, is what we call the grounded extension. So the grounded extension is the minimum, the least complete extension, the smallest, in a set kind of related sense. And it's the most skeptical of all. It's the one that says, I'm taking no chance at all as to which arguments are good, because I cannot. Am I sure about A? Well, if I choose A, I need to take a chance, because what if B instead? I mean, I could have chosen B. So there is a choice I have there. And the grounded extension, being the most skeptical, does not take chances, does not want to take chances. Yeah.
It's always a unique grounded extension.
There is always a unique grounded extension. It is indeed skeptical in that sense. There is one and only one. Whereas in all other cases, several extensions are not guaranteed to exist, as this example shows. All other extensions are guaranteed to exist for any argumentation frame. And the grounded extension, the least complete, is always always exists. So this is the actual definition of what grounded is. I already told you it is minimally complete. But there are other ways to be skeptical. And in particular, you can take the intersection of all preferred extensions, where preferred extensions are maximally admissible extensions. Or you can go for an in-between kind of step, which is what we call the ideal extension, which is maximal such that it is admissible and it is contained in every preferred extension. Don't look too puzzled. I mean, this is just a sample of the notions that are there. Argumentation theorists take great pleasure in defining semantics and studying the properties, how they're related, and so on. So we do quite a few different applications would require different philosophies, which are underlying these different semantics. However, in most practical uses, I've got to be honest with you, these semantics coincide. In many cases, they actually coincide. So in the case of this very simple example, the only grounded skeptically preferred and ideal extension is this set, the empty set will not be. So you are forced, even if you are fully skeptical, you are forced to take in merit, because you don't need to take a chance for in merit. There is no objection against it. So then you need to take in merit, if we look at grounded and complete, you need to take C merit. So this is the smallest complete. And there is only one preferred extension, and therefore the intersection of all preferred extensions just this. And this is the only set which is admissible and containing all preferred extensions, because it is the only preferred extension. So in this particular case, this is all there is. But there are examples and settings within which they differ. Of course, you need to be very, very creative to find examples where they differ, and that's one example again. This web of disagreement has two separate debates. One, A attacks B, attacks A back, and B attacks itself. And then we've got C and D that are attacking one another. They both disagree with E, which disagrees with S. That is the framework. So in this case, the grounded extension is empty. Can we elaborate as to why? Are you convinced that it's empty? There is a very simple heuristic to determining whether the grounded extension is empty. And the heuristic is there anything that is unattacked? If something is unattacked, then the ground extension cannot be empty, because that unattacked thing needs to be empty. But if nothing is unattacked, namely everything is attacked by something, then the ground extension is empty. So that's a very simple way to actually, it's a heuristics, but it works. So in this particular case, nothing is unattacked. Everything is attacked by something. So if you choose something to be in the ground extension, you're taking a chance. And therefore, you cannot, because the ground extension does not take a chance. So the ideal extension is A, right? So for it to be the ideal extension, it needs to be admissible. Is A admissible? Yes, it is, because it's attacked by B only, and it attacks back. It's obviously conflict-free. So it's conflict-free, and it defends itself against the only attack, B. So it's admissible. Okay? So is it contained in all preferred extensions? What are the preferred extensions? These are the maximally admissible extensions. So what are, you know, what are the maximally admissible extensions? Well, A will be in the maximally admissible extension. We have a choice between C and D. So we could add C, and then if we have C, then C defends F. So you would have F. Or you could choose D and again F. So you're going to have two preferred extensions, which are A, CF, and A, DF. So A is contained in every preferred extension. Is it the maximum admissible set contained in all preferred extensions? Yes, you can't add anything to it. So it is ideal. But what's skeptically preferred? Well, skeptically preferred is the intersection of all preferred extensions. I've already argued that ACF is one preferred extension, ADF is another preferred extension. So what's the intersection? It's AF. F belongs to both. So you would have that in this particular case, AF is the skeptically preferred. So you can see that although these three semantics are all skeptical, they are different. The ground is the most skeptical, it takes no chance at all. The ideal is skeptical, but someone says, oh, come on, you know, A is in every single preferred extension, why should we take a chance? The skeptical preferred extension is the least, it is the least skeptical. It takes some chance, in particular, it takes a chance on F, because F is in there, although it's not directly defended by anything in there. So it is brought into the skeptically preferred, but you know, there is no defense for it. So you could argue that it's not quite the right way to be skeptical. I don't like skeptical. It is skeptical without really being justified in its choices. Okay, so I've already made these points over and over again. There are possibly several alternative good extensions according to credulous semantics, such as admissible, preferred, complete, and stable. And there is only one single good extension, taking no chance, with different interpretations, according to other semantics, the skeptical ones, in particular, grounded, ideally, skeptically, and preferred. And this example is the clearer evidence of the difference, because in the particular settings, credulous semantics take a chance on A or B, whereas skeptical don't, in this case, they take no chance at all to get instead. Okay, so before we stop briefly for a hands-on exercise, I wanted to give you an alternative understanding of these semantics. These semantics are all sanctioning sets of arguments as good, as winning, as dialectically strong. Okay? So that's what they're doing. They say, give me a set of arguments, I'll tell you whether they're good or not good dialectic. There are different recipes, so it's like you've got different, you know, the same ingredients, you've got, I don't know, potatoes, meat, and tomato, and you can make different dishes out of these ingredients, but there are all ways to determine a dish which is something edible, okay? Something good. There is an alternative equivalent way to understand these semantics, which is more like logical, in quotes. And that's by means of so-called labels, which assign a label to each of the arguments, as either E, namely winning, out, namely losing, or undecided, don't know. So, semantics only tell you what is winning, basically, whereas labeling tell you the more fine grain. They tell you not just what's winning, but also what's losing and what's undecided. And there is a one-to-one correspondence between the in-labeling and the extensions kind of semantics. So, in particular, I want you to focus in the hands-on exercise on the complete labeling, which is basically saying that an argument is labeled in, if and only if. Every argument that attacks it is labeled out, and an argument is labeled out, if and only if some attacking argument is labeled in, which then means that everything else is undecided. So something is undecided if at least one attacker is labeled undecided and no attacker is labeled. So, this is in one-to-one kind of correspondence with a complete extension semantics, the one that says a set of arguments needs to be conflict-free, admissible, and contain everything in defense, in that all the in-arguments in a complete labeling are in a complete extension in the other interpretation. So, what I would like us to do now is spend maybe 5 minutes playing. In labeling, in particular, looking at the complete labeling using the system that Claudia Schultz developed. And so, if you can, I can show you that there are some existing frameworks to load. So, you can choose here which framework to load. So, this is the nationwide breakdown cover example. There is in that attacks not covered, which attacks covered. Okay, so that's exactly that example called A, B, and C's. And then what you do, so once you have loaded it, you basically visualize it down here. And then you are asked to label it. So you can label something in, and that's green. You can label something out, and that's red. Or you can label something white and that's undecided. And then you can go down here and say check, total labeling is complete in this case. So, and this will tell you this is not good. can you tell me why it is not good?
A should be in.
A should be in why?
Because it's attacked by another argument.
Yeah, so there is at least one out argument which is in. So, sorry, this should be in. Now, if we go, we can see this is correct. And you can also look at other types of labels, because there are equivalent labels to the preferred extension semantics. So a preferred labeling is a complete labeling with a maximum number of in arguments. And then there are other semantics. Stable labeling is a total labeling, which is everything is either in or out, so it's a complete labeling where everything is either in or out. And then there are other semantics that we have real time. Okay? Ah, and also the grounding. This is also grounding. You can check grounding, which is the minimum complete. The complete with the minimum in labeling argument. So I would encourage you to play with it for 5 minutes or so. So you can try other frameworks that are already in the system, or you can create your own. And you can create your own by just specifying here on this side, you can specify what your arguments are and what the attacks are, and then you visualize. So you could specify, for example, you also have an argument D here. So it would add this argument like that. Ah, there are some security issues. They have problems there as well. I think Firefox works. What are you using? Yeah, use Firefox. We have the same. necessarily we should argue there are some certain things in this account. We just do not think it's a security.
Yeah.
Do you mind?
I'm with Chrome.
Ah, with Chrome it works? Yeah. Maybe your setup is different. If you have any questions, please ask, and if you get fed up, I'll carry on, I'll move on. Taking out what is going on. So there are few frameworks for supporting structured argumentation. Assumption-based argumentation is the one I'm going to cover, but there are others, there is ASPIC, with or without preferences, there is divisible logic programming depth, and there is inductive argumentation. So we edited a special issue of the Journal of Argument and Computation in 2014 on structured argumentation, and all four frameworks are described there. So if you're interested about the others, go and have a look at that special issue. I'm going to focus on other. So another framework is a quadruple. It consists of a didactic system, the first two elements of the quadruple. The didactic system consists of a language, some logical language, and a set of rules which allow to draw inferences from the didactic system itself. So the only imposition that we have is that the system is compact, otherwise it's anything. The rules are often written simply as indicated there, but it's just syntactic sugar. You can write the inference rules whichever way you want. They have, however, a conclusion, sigma zero in the rule, and premises, sigma one to sigma n. So we also call sigma one, I use this interjectively as I speak, sigma one to sigma n, we call it the body of the rule, and sigma zero the head of the rule. All these sigmas are elements of the language. So the deductive system is really anything. It could be that your language is whole logic, is first order logic, is other logic, is whatever you want, really. The assumption by argumentation framework definition is completely generic. Amongst the sentences in the language, there are a few, at least one, that are identified as the assumptions. So these are sentences that, put very crudely, you are not obliged to derive in order to prove, but you can assume, you can make them up yourself. And these assumptions are the bits of the language you can disagree with, because they have a contrary, namely, in some cases, a negation, but anything really. You've got a way to disagree with these sentences, the assumptions. And this way to disagree with them is given by the contrary, which is a total mapping from the assumptions into the
group. You say it's a matrix, so there's always a single contrary.
There is always a single contrary, however, this is the basic framework. However, we have proven in practice so that you could actually have multiple contraries, or a set of contraries for each assumption equivalent to
this. In the natural language, if you say something is red, contrast to be white, yellow,
absolutely.
Black,
this can be modeled anyway.
Yeah.
Because if you want that, you can have the contrary of white is non-white,
yeah.
And then you have non-white defined by means of rules as red, black,
yeah.
So it is without loss of generality, yes.
So our contrary is automatically wrong because we're disagreeing with the assumptions.
It doesn't mean it's wrong, you may end up not assuming the assumption, it's not legitimate. And the contrary is right, it's just a way to disagree with the assumption. It's just a handle saying that you can disagree. So in a sense, what ABBA is doing is saying these are the issue of debate. Okay? The assumptions are really the real core of the debate. So you can disagree with these bits, and by disagreeing with these bits, the debate will fall. But it doesn't mean that the contrary is right and the assumptions are wrong or other. There is no such semantic. This is all syntactic. Just a handle for everybody. Okay, and there are questions about. I don't know how logically minded you are doing this. I'm asking what your backgrounds are. I assume it's a mixture.
I'm
is illogical. So for this is kind of clear. Is there somebody with a background who's not illogical at all? And this looks like gibberish. Okay, so good. So we are looking at
a... In any case, there is nothing we can do about this, right?
Shut up, I'm trying to explain it in more. So there are kind of special kinds of our frameworks that we provide computational counterparts of, which we call flat. And one way for a framework to be flat is that no assumption can be derived. So no assumption is the head of the rule. assumptions and the contraries of these assumptions. In this particular formulation, I am basically using the logic programming instance data, where the underlying language is the Herbian base of the set of rules, so it's a set of apples, basically, in the language. And also the negation hysteria of these, you know, the negation of these atoms, so these are the negation hysteria literals. And the assumptions are these negation hysteria literals, and their contraries, the contrary of the negation hysteria to X is X itself. Has anybody ever heard of logic programming, or is it all new to you? So if I say negation hysteria, is it something that you say, what?
Maybe.
So in kind of logic programming, negation is used as negation hysteria. So you would infer a negative literal, a not P, say, if you fail to prove P. So it's a computational method whereby you are using provability to determine negation or lack of provability. So if you cannot prove a certain atom P, then you say, okay, then now I can infer not P. I fail to prove P, so it's negation, S failure to very prove P. In the context of ALP, really, maybe we don't need to worry too much about that. What's important is that I have identified rules for covered and not covered, and I've introduced also a new atom covered prime. So Mary is covered in car C. If Mary is an account holder traveling in C, C is a private car, and I can assume something. And that something I write as a negation hysteria literal. Which is, I cannot prove that Mary is not covered. I cannot prove, so that's the first not, or I fail to prove what? That not covered Mary in the car. So I'm using assumptions which are, in this particular case, double negative. But the first negation is negation hysteria, so negation to prove, whereas the second one is just for classical negation. But it's very syntactic.
So the first one is the epistemic negation.
Yes. You can say I don't believe that covert is the case, that not covert is the case. I could have actually used auto-epistemic or non-monotonic monologic instantiations of these equivalents. So what's important is that I'm specifying a rule that allows me to build an argument for covered Mary in the car, covered Mary while traveling in the car. So instead of telling you that's an argument, which is I called C Mary before, now I am telling you that's a rule for building an argument. You need to reason in order to build an argument. And you need to ascertain whether Mary is an account holder, whether Mary is traveling in the car, and so on and so forth. And then there is some assumption, which is the handle for this argument. And the handle from the, I mean, and it is very kind of, you know, the disagreement is given by its negation. So here, I'm telling you, I can disagree with that assumption by proving its negation. So I can disagree with negation hysteria of not covered Mary C by proving not covered Mary C. And that's what the second rule allows me to do. So not covered Mary C is, again, some conditions. One of which is an assumption, because I've got the not covered up there. Just we should see it would work. Just here. Okay? So this is another assumption. Its negation, its contour is again it, so covered prime. And covered prime is defined by another inference rule. And then I've got inference rules, which are flagrant conditional, we call them facts. You cannot really, you don't need anything to prove them. They're just axioms of your language. So this is basically the set of rules that I have used to model reasoning with these two policies and the, you know, with exceptions and exceptions. And I've said that the assumptions are all the negative things that occur, and their contrary is the positive counterpart. So I've made a choice as to how I am going to construct arguments and disagree with these arguments within a specific deductive system and choosing assumptions and their contraries. And that's another thing. sets of assumptions. So here now we are saying, I'm giving you the ingredients of an abstract argumentation framework. I'm not giving you the abstract argumentation, I'm telling you, build it yourself. How? Use the rules, use the assumption, use the contracts. And you can use the rules and the assumptions to build deductions, kind of an argument in particular for a claim is a deduction for the claim supported by the assumptions and the rules that can be used to change it. So this is a deduction assumption. This could be in any deductive system. You can understand them as trees if you want, as in a forward, in a backward manner, whatever way you want. So you are basically telling the arguments, you need to work a little bit to obtain the arguments, reason with the rules, and use the assumptions as premises that don't need proof. Attacks then are directed at the assumptions, so one characteristic of ABA is that you can only disagree with assumptions, which means you can only disagree with the support of arguments, not with their conclusion. So if you want to disagree with the conclusion, you need to write assumptions that represent the conclusion. Yeah.
Yes, but I'm not sure about whether I know the answer, but I know that it is like this. What's the deep rationale for not allowing attacks on the conclusion?
The deep rationale is that ABA was first defined to capture a variety of existing frameworks for non-monotonic reasoning, and you didn't need that feature. You didn't need it. So it's not needed to capture different
laws. If you have a defeasible rule and you want to attack the conclusion without attacking the premises?
You can then, you need to, if you like, build a front end to a back end. That does the map, that maps it into a format that allows you to do that. So basically, one of the main motivations for ABA is to keep it as simple as possible while being expressive. So instead of throwing in lots of new things, is do with what you can. I mean, it's more concrete than abstract argumentation, but it is just enough to capture too many
things.
To express a lot. So to capture non-monotonic model logic as an instance of ABA, you don't need to disagree with it. To capture different logic, you don't need to disagree with it. To capture logic problems,
so
you don't need it.
It's economic.
It's economic. So it's an economical system.
But it's not more philosophical or theoretical
reason
for attacking the conclusion with physical rule.
Other than there is a philosophical argument, which is Occam's razor.
Oh, of course.
Right, yes. I mean,
what I meant is what usually happens in argumentation. I mean, if you want to model a real argumentation practice, that I'm disagreeing with the conclusion without disagreeing.
The premise is
the feasible. I mean,
So for this to be modeled in ABA, you need to be what I call a front end that would map it. I mean, the computational machinery works for this, but you can represent it in a way that mirrors it, and you as a user don't see. So I mean, one of the other main motivations for ABA was really have a system which is fully computational, that has that is equipped with machinery that allows really machines to get going. So indeed, we have lots of computational techniques for this, and I'm only doing one. So anything that can leverage on those by being a front end. So attack is directed just at the assumptions, and an argument attacks another if the conclusion, the claim of the first argument is the contrary of one of the assumptions in the set. So, sigma 1 is the claim of this argument. This attacks this other argument because sigma 1 is the contrary of some assumption in the support of the second. So it's irrelevant what sigma 2 is, and it's irrelevant what A1 is. All that matters for the attack is sigma 1 and A2. Okay? So, given rules and assumptions, you can build arguments. Given contraries, you can build attack. That is the bottom line. The bottom line is that you are looking inside and you have ways to actually define these things. Equivalently, in ABA, so once you do that, what you have in it is an abstract argumentation set. You have kind of defined your arguments and your attacks. So you have a web of disagreement. The nodes are the arguments, they have a structure, but they are the arguments, and the edges are the attack relationships as defined here. But in ABA, you can also think exclusively in terms of sets of assumptions. And in particular, determine whether sets of assumptions are good, because the sets of assumptions is what determines everything. So you will have that a set of assumptions attacks another set of assumptions, if and only if in this context, an argument supported by a subset of the first set of assumptions here attacks an argument supported by a subset of the second, and possibly in both cases, the full set. So you can basically define other semantics as an abstract argumentation by first obtaining the arguments and the attacks, or you can talk about semantics of ABA in terms of sets of assumptions by using this notion of attack, and then determining admissible sets of assumptions, say, that are sets of assumptions that are conflict-free, they don't attack themselves, and defend themselves against all attacks. I mean, all definitions that we have seen for abstract argumentation apply when given at the notion of, at the level of assumption. And actually, originally ABA, in the early days, was exclusively defined in terms of sets of assumptions, and only later, after some 10 years, the definition was equivalently given in this sentence, but the original definition was like this. So, in the particular, before we do that, in the particular setting of this example, you can build an argument for we claim cover Mary in the car. From what? From which premises? So the claim of the argument is this, and the premises are just this. Because you can deduce this away. Here it is. You can get rid of this. So the deduction only means this set of assumptions. You cannot have these as premises of the arguments because you only have assumptions as premises of the argument. And then you would, you need to have assumptions because you've got no ways to prove them, given that we have no argument for our frame. So you would construct an argument for cover, an argument for not cover supported by this set of assumptions, and an argument for cover prime supported by an empty set of assumptions. You don't need assumptions at all. And then the argument for cover prime, supported by an empty set of assumptions, will attack the argument for not covered MC, because it disagrees with the contrary of the assumption that supports it. And this argument, in turn, would attack the argument for covered MC, supported by the assumption not covered MC, because this sentence is the contrary of this assumption. So we would obtain exactly the same abstract argumentation framework, if we focus just on these arguments here, as we did in the abstract argumentation formulation. But here we have lots more arguments. For example, we have an argument for account holder of Mary. The claim is account holder, and the premise is an empty set of assumptions. You don't need assumptions to prove it. So it's an argument you cannot disagree with. And you would also have arguments for just not covered prime, say, which is supported by just not covered prime. So the assumptions from arguments which are supported by themselves. But the bottom line is that you could actually obtain the same behavior as we had for the abstract argumentation. So what I would like to do now, we have still half an hour to go, right? We're supposed to finish it later, aren't we? I see it half, but I would like to play a little bit with this system. This system also accommodates preferences, which I am ignoring at the moment. So if you go to the actual system, I have, and this I have, I'm going to show you first how it works, and then you play a little bit yourself. So you need to input another frame. And I have already pre-compiled a representation of the nationwide insurance example, a simple version, in which we have assumptions for not cover, negation is failure of not cover, negation is failure of cover prime, and so this is exactly what we had. So let me see whether I can minimize.
Ready.
So this is basically. How do I kill this one here? I don't know. How do I kill this one here? You know? Well, I just wanted to show them at the same time. I don't know. Can you see, or is it too small?
Oh, there's a arrow to the left. Oh, go down with the button to the middle.
Ah, yeah. Good. Thank you. So this is basically a representation of this framework. So we've got the assumption, start with the assumptions, a negation is very literal, these are the only two that matter, symbolic with these two. And then they're written as my assumption. Then I specify the contraries of the two assumptions, so this is given here. And then there are the rules, these are the feasible rules, like the three top ones. And then these are the rules with an empty body, okay? So I am just writing it more simply.
Yeah. You need to increase the font in the left there.
Here?
Yeah.
Yeah,
right.
How?
Control plus.
Okay. Is that better?
Full value better.
So basically the point is that this is a representation of that. I mean, if you want, I can send. If you're interested in having this representation, send me an email and I will send it to you. It's not available in the system. So what the system, you specify another framework, and then what the system does is that it visualizes the attack relationship between sets of assumptions. So this is done at the assumption level. So in this particular case, we've got the empty set of assumptions attacks not cover prime, not cover prime, that assumption, because the cover prime, if you look now on the right hand side here, because cover prime is, there is an argument for cover prime supported by the empty set of assumption. Therefore, there is an argument against the assumption not cover prime supported by the empty set. So this is this attack, and because not cover prime is attacked by the empty set, it's also attacked by itself and by anything. Any superset of the empty set will attack. So you can see that you obtain automatically the attack relationship between sets of assumptions, and in particular sets of assumptions that play a role. And then you can compute the extensions, and again there are various types of extensions, and highlight the extensions. The green means it's in the extension, so in this particular case the extension would have not non-covered. So Mary is covered because there is a rule. They say if you can assume not covered, then you infer covered. So the assumption level, that's what is in and out. And down here, you can actually see what the extension is, or what is supported. In particular, covered, Mary being covered is supported. And you can also choose different extensions. These are all the extensions that are implemented in this system. And you can compare with, so you can actually have a comparison across different, if there are different extensions, then in this case there aren't any, it's only one extension, so the comparison doesn't really make sense. So I don't know whether we actually have time to play with it, but that's a good system to get a feeling as to what ABBA is doing at the level of computational extension. So there is computational machinery for ABBA in terms of dispute derivations that ascertain whether a specific claim, for example, that Mary is or is not covered, is belonging to a good extension. And this is the top-down method that takes a query and assesses it and constructs a debate. You can find a system, there are several such systems actually on my website, but it requires installing and I decided to go completely web-based for this tutorial. So this system computes extensions, there are other systems that answer query for ABBA. I don't know, do you want to play with it 3 minutes or do you want me to move on?
Is there, would you have the please send me the example?
Yeah, if you actually send me an email, I'll send you the example, but not immediately because this is not. But you can play with with other things. You can make up your start small and see what happens. Vote. Shall we play with it or for 3 minutes or not? Who wants to play with it? Okay,
sorry. We all abstain. We all abstain.
Okay, if you play with it, then I will not tell you much about the next one. We can play in the brain. Okay. Right, another example now. Let's move. The third topic I want to cover is that of bipolar argumentation. A very good illustration of why we need bipolar argumentation is given by looking at online reviews. Nowadays, you find online reviews for everything. You may find online reviews for how good I am as a lecturer or not, I don't know. So you will find reviews for most things, and before deciding anything, we look at reviews, whether to book a hotel, whether to go someplace, to eat out, and what, and so on. So this is a very simple example of what you would find on online reviews. This is taken from Goodreads, and it's two reviews about the book, The Handmaid's Tale, that some of you may have read. Has anybody read this book? Okay, so two people have read it. I think everybody should read it. I recommend it, so I have a positive review of this book. But not this one here, but you find conflicting opinions about this book. So this is an example of one review from this lady called Emily May, who said that there are only a handful of books that are really affecting me. So she really liked it, 5 stars. And then there is some Victoria. They gave it 2 stars and said that it's not a very well written book. So it's the kind of book that raises disagreement, that brings disagreement to the table. When you look at online reviews, you need to resolve this conflict somewhat. And you don't just have disagreement with what you believe or what people tell you, but you also have agreement. So you don't just have attack, you also have support. So in particular, this small example, ignore the top part, this small example can be seen as a debate where read The Handmaid's Tale is argument A1. There is an objection by Victoria that says it's not very well written. And there is an agreement from, I think it was Amy, I can't remember the name of the lady, or Amy, whatever, that says very few books have affected me the way this one has. So there is disagreement, but there is also agreement. So there is also support. So bipolar argumentation frameworks are not frameworks with the mental health problems. There are frameworks where you've got attack and support. You have, in addition to the standard relationship of attacks, if you have an absolute implementation framework, you also have a support relationship. It's just another relationship. They can also be represented as graphs, but now you've got 2 types of edges. Here I indicate as straight edge for attacks I've done so far, and double edge for support. Okay, so this is a different kind of argumentation framework that people have extensively looked at in the literature. And again, people have given a whole variety of semantics for these frameworks in terms of extensions. And given only the time I've got, I'm not sure I'm going to spend much time on this. But basically, what you can basically interpret this way to set in good extensions as identifying coalitions of arguments via the notion of support somewhat. So, for example, you could say that according to one interpretation of bipolar argumentation frameworks, that A1 and A3 are together, are a coalition, right? In particular, according to the deductive support interpretation, A3 will support A1, so we bring A1 to the table necessarily. So A2 attacking A1 will also attack A3. Because A3 will always have A1 with it. I can see you look up, and indeed it's non-trivial to see how to interpret this notion of support. That's one interpretation under deductive support. There are other interpretations that interpret support as necessary, which amounts to somewhat reversing the deductive interpretation so that the support goes from A1 to A3. These are just two notions. There are very many notions. And the good news is, and I'm not going to give you details, the good news is that you can capture all these notions, all existing notions, in structured argumentation, and in particular in a very restrictive form of, in structured argumentation, and in particular in a very specific form of our frameworks, which we call bipolar, where rules always have just one element in the body. The semantics of other frameworks correspond to whichever interpretation you want of support, but I don't have time to go into details. What I want to point out, to draw the attention to, is that no matter what different notions do, sanctioning a set of arguments as good, and here I'm trying to argue as to why they may be useful in different contexts. They have something in common, and they have it in common with actual argumentation. And what they have in common is that they do not accrue as semantics. So, in particular, look at this very simple example, the one you saw, the one about the handmaid's tale. You've got a review against reading it and a review for. So suppose that you have another review against reading it, for the sake of argument. So from the viewpoint of abstract argumentation, if you ignore the support, or bipolar argumentation according to these extensions, you would say that A1, this set, is equally not good. So the new attack does not bring anything. Okay? So if A1 was not good before, it is still not good after. Nothing changed. So there are very many semantics, and here I just want to for you to be shocked by this. So the aim of this is for you to be shocked. There are very many semantics that incorporate this accrual, this idea of accrual. So there are very many ways to do it. And this is a table we recently put together in the context of studying properties of these different methods of accrual and seeing how, you know, which properties they fulfill or not, and a way to discriminate amongst them. So all of these, except for the bottom one, which is complete labeling, which is the one we have looked at, are semantics for either abstract argumentation or bipolar argumentation or support-only kind of argumentation where accrual is accumulating. And they are so-called gradual semantics. So instead of saying that things are good or not good, or in the case of blaming that are in, out, or undecided, these semantics ascribe to arguments a number, typically, or an element of an order set. And it's a number within some kind of interval. None of these goes to infinity, but some of the metrics we have included in this table also allow from zero onwards. So you basically say, tell me how strong an argument is. So there are gradual semantics because you can capture nuances between arguments by saying how little, how much they differ in terms of strength. So some of these frameworks are for abstract argumentation, that's what A2BAF means here. Some are for bipolar argumentation, some again are for abstract, some are for frameworks or your label support. So the main difference on as to whether they consider one relation only or both, they may differ in terms of where they choose the strength of arguments from, which kind of interval, and they are also different in a number of other details, like whether arguments come with an intrinsic strength before you start arguing about. So you can assess how good an argument is, maybe because it has been logically built nicely, that's not, maybe it's an empty limb and you don't quite trust it, and therefore its intrinsic original strength is not code. Or maybe some expert has told you it's not a very good argument, and therefore its initial strength is quite low. So in some approaches, you have an idea, you know, a starting point for the strength, in others you don't. In some approaches, you decide what to do with arguments that have a bottom strength. Where bottom, this bottom here, could be 0, minus 1, depends on what you are, you know, what your kind of given set. And then you also have ways to compare different strengths differently. So you can see that there is a huge variety available, and what I'm going to do now is focus on one particular method, which is the one that we have implemented in the argument system I asked you to look at the beginning. And this system assumes that arguments come with what we call a base code, which is the initial intrinsic strength for arguments. The strength, the dialectical strength of arguments is determined by aggregating the strength of the attackers against an argument and the strength of the supporters for this argument. So the way, I'm not going to give you the formula, but the way this works is that first you look at all the attackers against an argument, and you recursively determine their strength. Then you look at all the supporters and you recursively determine their strength and you aggregate them. You massage the strength, the aggregated strength of the attackers and the aggregated strength of the supporters to obtain the strength of an argument. And if an argument has got no attackers and supporters, then its strength is the intrinsic strength, is the base. So the base code plays a role in determining what the dialectical strength is. In this particular example, if A2 and A3, they both start with the same base code, with the same intrinsic strength, which I assume it's 0.5, which is the middle of the interval that this method relies upon, which is 0.1. So strength of arguments is between 0 and 1, possibly included. So assuming that every argument has strength 0.5 to start with, then the strength of A1 will be 0.5. Because if there is one attack, the attackers and supporters, the balance each other out. But if you add a further attacker, then now the attacker, the aggregate strength of the attackers is higher, and the strength is closer to 0, because in the merging of the two, the attackers play a bigger role. So you have a macroid. And of course, the initial base code plays a role. So if, for example, we start with everything having strength 0.5, but the second argument having a very high intrinsic strength, 0.9, then to start with, A1 will not be having a strength in the middle, because the attacker is stronger now. A2 has a higher strength, it's almost the top strength. B will decrease the strength of A1, but not as much as before, because A1 is already quite weak due to the high strength of A2. So there is an interplay between the intrinsic strength the arguments come with and the dialectical aggregation as they go down. Okay, so I've got 5 minutes left, and I would like to play with this argument system to show you in practice what you can do with it and how it integrates this notion. So I think you are the one that can debate with me. Anybody else? No, I think I have it in this. Okay, so. Can you see this debate yourself? What's your name?
Merlin, I have to log in.
Oh, anybody else who has registered and want to get into the debate? Did you try again?
Yeah, I think I don't know why it's on.
I mean, I guess we can just do. You said Bernard is your name, is it? So we just need one person. I mean, everybody, this is a distributed system, so anybody can debate with anybody as soon as they are joined in the same debate. So I've chosen just a topic. Oh. so I have chosen a topic which is, I guess, that we, anybody who works in AI is sick and tired of nowadays, but nonetheless, so will AI endanger society? So that's the question. And there are two answers, yes or no, and ARGENDEC, stands for argue and decide, allows to evaluate the two alternative decisions, yes and no, dialectically, by empowering arguments in a bipolar argumentation framework to be added. So, say again your name, Ben.
Norland, like the wizard.
Like it? Merlin,
like the
wizard. Merlin. So Merlin, it's me and you now, aren't you? Okay, let's try. Do you want to argue to argue for yes or for no?
For no.
Go on. You know, you do it. Add an argument. The way you do is if you want to argue for no, so you want to add a pro argument for no. So if you click here, I'll for the sake of argument, I'll add one.
There is a B.
Yeah. Any other mistakes?
No, it's okay.
Okay. So what is it? Okay. So you add arguments, and then I say yes, there it is. So and then once you've added the argument, you link it to the answer you want to. So in this case, you probably want to. Okay, let me say that it's like this, right? Is this what you intended?
Right.
And then, actually, in this particular case, because the answer was yes or no, we could just debate one of the two. And for example, I could add a con argument. This is exactly what you say. The AI can be shut off, which is exactly the argument you had, but then I added as an argument against it. So in this particular system, an argument has a type, rather than typing the relationship, we type the arguments as pros and cons. So a relationship from a plus argument means a support, a relationship for a con argument means an attack. But because we type arguments, an argument cannot be both attacking something and supporting something else. You need to copy. So that's what I've done here. So it's a characteristic of the specific system that we developed so that engineers could work with it. And it's based upon a particular conceptualization called IBIS that engineers use. So we developed it in collaboration with engineers, and that's why it has the features it has. So basically, you can leave the debate, and we carry on. If any of you want to join the debate, they can, if I add them on. What's important is that once you have the debate, then you can do what we call here compute values. So the compute values determine according to two arguments, the DF quad, which is the one I've illustrated in the slides, as well as an earlier version of that, which we call quad. So DF quad means discontinuity-free qualitative argumentation debates. And you can see that given the arguments that are there, no is stronger, has a strength of 0.75, whereas yes has 0.5. Yes has 0.5 exactly for the reason why in the example on the slides, the argument A1 and 0.5, because there is a perfect balance between attackers and supporters. Whereas no has a higher 0.75 because it's only supported, it's not argument. So you can play with this system and, for example, determine that if you look here, if you look at the information, there is a base value which is the strength, the intrinsic strength of the argument. You can put it much lower, much higher. So now put it very low. So it's only 0.1 out of in the interval 0.1. So now the supporter is very weak. Okay, so I weaken the supporter a lot. So when I actually compute the values, this means that the yes has even got a lower value, because the only supporter it has is very weak. So I'm not really sure about its strength. questions about? You look kind of puzzled. More than for other things I've done. Why? This should be the most intuitive framing system.
So what's the difference between the quad and the F-quad?
The F-quad is basically such that it has no gaps in strength. Quad is jumpy at times. So it can be discontinuous. So it's a technical way to define what happens at the once you get closer to the extreme case, it's 0 and 1. But it's a minor difference. And at the moment, really, I mean, the system was originally defined for quad, but we are almost exclusively using it for the F quad.
And does it work if we graph, right?
No, okay, so this system is only implemented for trees. So it doesn't accommodate cycles. We have defined the semantics for the F quad in the presence of cycles as well, but it's computationally much more demanding. So the calculation implementation only works for trees, and actually, when working with engineers, that's all we need, basically. So we are actually using this system for lots of things. I'll show you other examples other than this simple. So we are using it, I'm just trying to see whether we have any examples which are. Okay, so this is, could it be? No, this is not very good. So we have several now, sorry, I don't, So this is an engineering example, where you, basically the problem was about which is the best method and device for controlling the biological process in wastewater treatment plants. So that's something that some engineers came up with, and then you can analyze, you can basically run into the system and determine which option, which solution is kind of best. We also have looked at using this in medical setting, and in particular for applying guidelines to patients with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. And again, in medics, and that's what the medics came up with. So you can see that as soon as you start putting lots of information about what plays a role, the capability of evaluating the debate is crucial. Because otherwise you have no guidance as to what is working, what's not working. So the original ID system was exclusively for representation purposes. The bipolar argumentation gradual semantics provide guidance as to how to, what to do with them. Okay, this system it's open, as you know, to everybody, and you can play with this later on.
Is there other stuff for example debates? Are those example debates accessible?
No, but I can give you access to some of them are private. I can give you access to others if you register and you send me the. Okay, so I had two other parts to cover, but I guess I won't have time because the time is over. So I wanted to deal with preferences and probabilities, which are actually both very important for applications nowadays, but I won't have time. So I'm going to. Because I'm supposed to finish at 11, am I right?
Yes.
Yeah. So I'm going to go to, I can share the slides with whomever. I'm going to jump to the conclusions. I've given you basic information, basic notions about outside argumentation, bipolar argumentation, and structured argumentation, mostly flat ABBA, and not much about the rest, really. And in addition to omitting these bits here, the bipolar ABBA and this line basically, I also need to provide information about how the computation is performed, what properties are studied of these tremors, what concrete instances have been deployed and used in which settings, what happens when you deploy this type of argumentation across intelligent agents rather than within an individual agent, and so on. So there is a lot that I'm covering, but I've given you the foundations. I hope that those of you who are not yet working in this field will be motivated to look at it and maybe contribute to it in the near future. Thank you.